that I wish that this opportunity was a little under a little better circumstances, right? But we had something that kind of definitely has had a significant change or impact on the landscape of pork, U.S. pork production here that started this May. And so I'm going to basically share a little bit of kind of an update on that, what's gone on, at least from the perspective of in my role here at the laboratory. And so I'm the one talking today, I guess, but really I want to share is this, the stuff that we're going to be sharing is really from the view of the lab, and these are the folks that I really have the great honor and privilege to work with every day. The Diagnostic Lab, for those who may not be aware, is housed at the College of Veterinary Medicine at Iowa State there in Ames, and we're a team of about 22, 23 faculty, and then something just north, a little north of 100 technical staff. And what this team of people does every day is a lot of this. We process a little more than 55,000 cases a year, so it's just roughly over 1,000 cases a week that we get in, and probably 90% of what we get comes in some sort of box with pieces and parts and fluids and anything they'll send, we'll test it. So so we kind of run it through the mill of the different ancillary labs and report the results out to our practicing veterinarians who are our direct clients, who in turn are working for you, the pork producer. And we're somewhat unique from a diagnostic lab from the standpoint of we tend to be very heavily weighted towards serving pork producers in the U.S. swine industry. And so we're about 75% of what we do is for pigs, 10% bovine, 10% poultry, and about 5% of everything else. And you can see this here, this thing right there, really that's all really related, directly associated with the PEDV as it really ramped up as we got into the cold weather this fall. And so again, the reason we do so many pigs is kind of where we are in relationship to where the pigs are. And then also, there's just so many pigs that move into the state, a little over 500,000 a week that cross the border into Iowa to be fed. And so we do a lot of work for the producers that are raising pigs outside of the state but shipping them in. And so because of these, our tremendous systems of logistics we enjoy in the U.S. has really concentrated swine diagnostics to a few labs in the states. So just real quick, and I'm not going to get into a lot of this, and Bush is going to cover some of this too, but just real quick, what is PEDV? PEDV is a virus. It's a coronavirus, so it's very, and that's really in the same family of what historically I think we've all known as TGE virus, okay? And it behaves clinically very much the same as far as how it spreads, this kind of thing, how it affects mortality in breeding herds and so on. And it's definitely not a zoonotic or disease or food safety issue. It's a pig disease, a pig concern. And I think kind of in short has really been maybe described as a little bit of TGE on steroids. And I think that's probably fairly pretty fair. And so kind of the history of, you know, where is this virus? This is not a new virus. So it's not a new virus to the world. It's a new virus to the U.S. So it's not like PERS in the late 80s. Oh, this came out of nowhere, right? This was an existing virus that was active elsewhere in the world and then got introduced into the U.S. and subsequently spread. It's interesting, they go way back into the early 70s. There's mention of this disease being first identified in the literature and so on, prevalent in Western Europe during that time, but has since essentially become a non-issue in that area of the world. When you look at that, the viruses that came from that era, they are definitely genetically distinct from that. So the virus that we're dealing with today is very much essentially identical to the PEDV that's been causing some and continues to cause significant disease in the Southeast Asia, namely China and a bit in South Korea. And again, was first confirmed in the U.S. this May. And so what this graph really represents is just the number of PEDV cases that have been observed across the diagnostic labs in the U.S. Over time since this thing first was identified. Started here this spring, and as you can see, has been a really significant ramp up with, you know, I think it's, I don't know what that is, about 750 breeding herds, something like that. And what we've really noticed with that has been that we kind of went along and we had this significant surge. The first cases were in the Midwest, rate, and then it got into a pocket of fairly intensive sow production in the southwest, what we call the southwest U.S., southwest pig belt anyway, out in the panhandle of Oklahoma and Texas, and that's really what this surge is here, and then kind of fairly steady throughout the summer, and then it got into the Carolinas right in here, and then once it got cold in the Midwest, it really took off. And so this table here just kind of summarizes kind of the peak activity of the virus as far as some of this early on. Again, these first cases essentially were in the Midwest, was into a lot of Iowa finishing. Then it got down into the panhandle of Oklahoma and Texas and kind of exploded in there in a matter of a few weeks. And then here in early September, got a hold into where there's some more concentrated production in the southeast in North Carolina. And then once we started getting some colder weather, it really is kind of taking a hold here in the Midwest in a very significant way. So just real quick on the diagnostics and so on as far as how that works. I'm sure many of you maybe have been familiar with this as you've been getting into it, is that it's a fecal oral disease. It's on the virus itself is in and on everything that has feces in them or on them and that kind of thing. And so, you know, the basic specimens are intestines, fresh and fixed, feces, fecal swabs. And probably one of the most surprising things I would say from a diagnostic standpoint anyway is how well oral fluids has been been proving itself as a very valid and sound specimen for PEDV diagnostics. It's because we wouldn't have normally thought of that because it isn't a systemic disease. It's not circulating the animal, but there's just enough feces in these oral fluids because the pigs are always sampling their environment right in the pen, licking the slats and feeders and those kinds of things. And so that's really made this oral fluid to really stand out as a solid specimen for this disease as well. And then, of course, we do have one antibody test online today. Okay. And so the primary technology that's being used for PEDV diagnostics has been a PCR assay. This was something that we're fortunate with some of the DNA-based technologies that exist today. We were able to get those kind of tests up and running in very short order. And those are now, they're widely available and so on. I put in here a learning curve on the extraction techniques that were being used. And the reason I say that is that the amount of virus in these acutely affected animals, so the acutely affected neonates and so on, it's extraordinary. I mean, we're not sure we've seen so much virus in a fecal sample that at least that we have on record anyway. So it's just an extraordinary amount of virus these acutely affected pigs are secreting into the environment. And so we think that's definitely playing a role in how contagious this bug is. And again, widely available and has been the core diagnostic tool. And so it's an extremely sensitive test, it's a specific test, and all same-day type testing. The same thing here with PEDV IFA. It's the only serology test. So we use PCR, and that detects antigens. So that's looking for the virus. Is it there? Is it not? Okay. And what we use antibody tests for, that's more of an indication of has the animal seen it in their past or not. So it takes them a few weeks to develop an antibody response. And so this is looking for past exposure. And Dr. K.J. Yoon and his group there at the lab were really the first ones to bring an antibody test on. And it continues to be the only one that I would know of that is, quote, commercially available. And now it's been made available at our other diagnostics labs as well. And we're actively pursuing, as are others, an ELISA test. Okay? And so an ELISA test, the same kind of thing. It's an antibody-based test. We're looking for antibodies. But those tests to date have not been made commercially available as of this point. We have one internally that we think it's really close. But again, it is not on board today, and there's a number of folks doing that. And the other thing that's interesting as we got into this, because I was saying PEDV is not a new disease, it's not new around the world, but there were some commercial ELISA tests, PEDV ELISA tests available in South Korea and China, and so we were able to import some of those, and just the performance of those assays were very, very poor, and so that's what required us to kind of go our own route in development. And so essentially, what's being done and how these diagnostic tools are being used, the mainstream for diagnosis, yes or no, is being used PCR for people that are interested in not as just is it circulating, but have they seen it in the past, primarily for people that are screening breeding stock and things like that, then they may choose to use both a PCR-based tool, again, that looks for active infection, active circulation, as well as the IFA tool to look for previous exposure. Virus isolation, again, we've had some good luck of doing that, but it's a very difficult bug to grow. Okay, so it's not really, it's not VI or virus isolation isn't necessarily a viable option for a diagnostic tool, but it's definitely was success in getting that done was very critical in us getting this serology antibody-based assay on board because you have to be able to grow the virus to do that IFA test, right? And then this is also playing a role if there's down the road, if there's any modified live type vaccines that come available, will largely be an outcome of using this technology. And so primarily VI, it is possible, but primarily for research purposes and not for commercial diagnostics. Sequencing early on, we'd say for research purposes, and we've now just recently offered it just like we would for traditional PER sequencing or SIV sequencing, and that has just most recently been onboarded as a routine offering now at the lab. And what this shows is with this dendrogram that Dr. Yoon has provided us here is it shows where this initial isolate clusters to this these Chinese or the PEDV isolates that had been most recently active in China. So there's a thing that they call GenBank, where scientists from around the world can deposit genetic sequencing data, right? So other researchers can assess to say, how does this compare to what's been identified elsewhere in the world and this kind of thing. And so this was an example where there was really a lot of value in that. So our folks here could say, well, this is the virus we have. How does it compare to other PEDV isolates around the world? And ironically, I mean, how it's like in today's world of molecular diagnostics and all the capabilities that come along with that, it's like, well, you're able to not only identify the pathogen, but then also identify where in the world it came from, right? And the $100,000 question is, well, how did it get here, right? And in that, the answer to that is nobody knows. We just really, the only thing we would know is the area of the world that had been most recently identified. Another test used on fresh or on fixed tissue, so that'd be stuff you know from gut that you put in formalin, submit that, would be IHC again. But this is an assay that's you know has been common for TG and so on, but it's showed to be incredibly insensitive for PEDV diagnostics. And the reason that is this shows say, okay, this is just a picture of a normal pig's gut, right? This is 8 hours after infection of a neonatal pig, and all that brown staining is the staining of PEDV virus, right? So just engulfs the intestine, right, in a matter of hours. And then this is this same pig here at 36 hours, okay? And essentially all these villi, right, so these are all the villi that absorb all the nutrients and so on, they're gone, right? And so that's why it's so deadly in these neonatal pigs, just because essentially you get this very aggressive villus atrophy, and then the pigs aren't able to absorb nutrients, right? And so then this is that same thing stained with this IHC, and so you can see this is why it's been so insensitive, because all this stuff that it was sticking to is gone. That makes sense. So PEDV, and Butch will get into a lot more of this than I will, but I think some of the key take-homes about the virus is that it's been able to, you know, rapidly spread across broad regions of the country. It really likes anything that feces can stick to, okay? And, of course, transportation, lairage, this kind of thing is shown to be a significant factor. And also, it's also showed how, from a vulnerability standpoint, there's so much animal movement that occurs today in our U.S. pork industry. And it kind of this web of trucks and so on that's moving and crisscrossing across the country. And this virus definitely likes trucks. So that's really been a key part of how it's moved. And it's kind of interesting, some of this work early on, yep, there's an awful lot of it at the plants, meaning there was a lot more positive trucks. The number of trucks that were positive coming in was amplified, I think, by a factor of 1.2 that was leaving the plants because of, you know, back and forth at the lairage facility and so on. And then, interestingly enough, some veterinarians in the East Coast had done some swabbing of some of these coal stations, and this is before it broke in North Carolina, and essentially what was happening is these coal stations were positive for PEDV prior to any pigs in the area being positive, and then the first farms that broke in the Carolinas were actually around the coal stations. Okay, and the deal there was is that evidently there were coal pigs being hauled back from the Midwest to coal killers somewhere on the East Coast, you know, and so they drop off there and then they go to this coal south pickup place and that kind of thing. So it just, reemphasizes the kind of this web of a U.S. pork industry that we all are a part of. Area spread has been very, very obvious in walking through traditional biosecurity mechanisms. That's been most obvious in the areas of high breeding herd concentration, as far as once it's in an area, its ability to readily move between farms in what would, I think, otherwise be identified as unprecedented periods of time, as far as how quick the thing can move. And kind of the impact has been, this was some information that was shared again from some veterinarians here, and basically just showing kind of what is the impact on this series of eight farms. These are eight, you know, 2,500 head sow farms, naive. What is the impact on their wean pig productivity? And kind of in short, it was about what they observed in this set of data was about four weeks losses of wean pigs, and then about another week, 18 to 20 weeks later, because the sows got so sick, so these animals that were shortbred, when they were feeding back, the conception rates went down to like 40-50%, something on those. Okay. And then the other thing I would say is on this too is that the severity of the disease, again, a lot of clinical reports is it's very age or stage of production dependent. Okay. And the reports on grow finish sites becoming infected and the amount of clinical signs has been quite variable. And because of sometimes acute diarrhea can look like there's a lot of things that cause diarrhea in growing pigs, it sometimes can otherwise be missed. And probably why that's so important would be especially for people that are growing gilts up off-site, okay? And I think the reason for that is if you're growing up gilts off-site and you're bringing them back into a breeding herd is you probably want to understand what's going on with them because it for certain can be missed in growing pig situations. Other kind of take-home things is shedding, just an awful lot of it being shed. So kind of the difference is, I would say, sort of TG, how does it compare? There's a lot more virus being shed, and it's shed for quite a bit longer. So it's more, longer. I think the earliest reports, again, this would be coming back from our clients and some practitioners, is about probably the earliest of weaning PEDV negative pigs following a break has been 90 days. And that's essentially been a kind of standalone breeding herds that just feed back, close the door, let it burn itself out. About 90 days has been as far as getting backs, and that's probably been, I would say, best case scenario. And in growing pig populations, monitoring growing pigs in those kind of settings has been definitely detecting PEDV being shed and circulating anyway in that group of grow finish population for at least 6 to 8 weeks post exposure. So it hangs around for quite a while. And probably the singular biggest issue, I think, in my mind anyway, is what does the endemic phase of this disease look like? Because some of this is, it all hasn't been going so well, okay? Where traditionally how we've managed TG, you do this, you feed back, you're good, right? You get through this hiccup and you're back and everybody's happy, so to speak. And you're back in a normal routine. And with this bug, is that hasn't always been the case, meaning and it's kind of, you know, this is a difficult number to know because it's all, there isn't any where that information's being captured. It's just people's experiences and people talking about their experiences and so on. But it's somewhere, you know, around this 70-30, something like this about these farms aren't all just responding how you would like to think they should respond. And one of the things that's come back for certain as a one theme in this is that this dose in the farrowing rooms is huge. So what it means is that it sure appears anyway that dose in the environment can overcome the immunity that may be there. Okay, and maybe immunity is waning, not sure about that, but for certain dose in that wean pig population is important. And so the whole sanitation stuff in these farrowing crates and farrowing rooms and all-in, all-out farrowing rooms it's a different level than what we've, I think, become accustomed to. And some of this has been, maybe where it's been more obvious to some is where they've, folks have had farrowing rooms and so on that were not infected because they weaned down. So it's one of the things that people are doing is they're weaning down in the acute phase of a break. And so they didn't ever get those rooms infected, okay, those farrowing rooms. And so when they're coming back to those rooms and farrowing, no problem. They get back to the rooms where they were infected, problems, right? So it definitely appears that the sanitation is a paramount thing in this. And the other thing is that broadly becoming endemic in the U.S. Very quickly. The other few comments here, and then I'll try to close with this and then turn it over to Butch, is I think the other thing that there's just been an awful lot here is to say, what does it say from our broader state of preparedness, right? And so, and this would be, I guess, from the view here, what we see in working with practitioners who are working with pork producers all over the country, from the general state of a preparedness. And one of the things that's changed a lot, and this group would be very well attuned to that, is that we're all a part of an industry, working with an industry that has markedly become dependent, so to speak, on exports, right? Export markets have been a tremendous factor in fueling growth and in the U.S. swine industry, with over about 25% right now of the tonnage, a little more than that of the value. And so, and this has really changed a lot, not only for us, but the poultry people are the same. Same for the chickens, and more beef being exported as well. And this is really because of, as societies around the world are maturing in their and increasing their earning potential and so on, increasing their quality of life, the first thing they want to do is eat more meat, right? And so they have reached out to the U.S. to help get some of that. And so I think one of the questions we have, I think, as the animal health community, so to speak, is are we keeping pace to be in a position to support that dependence on export markets? And so I would say this is kind of a little bit of that, I think this opportunity is globalization. Everybody talks about globalization, right? That's the, you know, it's kind of the ways of the world. And so I think one of the things that we, in our thing of where we are, it's probably both the biggest opportunity, it's probably the biggest upside for this industry and others like ours, and also it's maybe one of the biggest challenges, okay? And the reason it's one of the biggest challenges is because you have some health risk that can change that on a dime, right? And so because of, you can have some diseases that are entered into the country that one would call foreign animal diseases that can have immediate impact on trade impacting diseases. And so it's like there's all kinds of opportunities in U.S. animal agriculture to really lead the world in the high quality food production and really be a sustainable, repeatable industry that's helping feed the world this high quality protein that we produce. But it also comes with it a significant risk. And I think one of the biggest things that as we've gone through this again is that is our health management infrastructure, is it up to par with our dependence on the export market? And so there's a lot of things that need to be enhanced at the laboratory, both locally as well as at our federal labs to enhance the preparedness of our labs. Basically, do we have all these tests? For example, when PEDV came, we didn't have that test, right? Why didn't we have that test? So we quickly developed the test, but we didn't have it in place to go that day. And the reason that's so important is when you have an introduction of a new disease, right? What are some of your first questions is going to be like, well, where is it at? Do you have the tools to be able to identify that, such that you're in a position to respond if you're so inclined to do so? And so there's a big need for improved diagnostics around in this country, and a significant need to say is how do we enhance our systems of information? And maybe some of the more senior folks in this group were actively involved in pseudorabies and the eradication of pseudorabies in this country and so on. And you think about when that was done. Right, largely done in the 90s, the late 90s. And maybe I think Iowa was the last to finish, I think, officially done in 2000, something like this. But that was all with papers and pens and clerks and people writing things down and a whole lot of vets running around bleeding these pigs and filling out certificates, right? There's been a lot of change in the world since that time in information management technologies, right? But it hasn't hit this, okay? Meaning we haven't, from an animal health infrastructure standpoint, we haven't necessarily adapted the IT tools that are available, right? And so there's a significant need to say is how do we enhance this network? And that's largely because we haven't been managing any program like diseases, okay? If you ask today to say, well, how many diseases do we say we actually know the health status of the farms, the pig farms in the U.S. for, right? How many diseases, how many are positive, how many are negative? Pick your disease. The only thing we really know a whole lot about are the ones we don't have in the country, right? And we can say, well, we're negative for those. And that's about it. So there's definitely some significant infrastructure needs here to enhance our response capabilities and things like that. And those are all part of some real key covenants of some things that are being developed for not only the U.S. Pork industry, but also our allied protein industries of eggs, milk, turkeys, beef, is that they're called these secure food security plans. And basically what they're built around is to be able to be in a position to move animals within the production phase and then animals to slaughter if we're in the face of a foreign animal disease outbreak, to say you can prove that you're free so you can safely move animals that are unaffected, right? And the USDA as a whole has been very supportive of those of these efforts because of the significant lack of federal funding that would be available for indemnity. So our needs are very practical, but they are very significant. And a lot of it is about, say, we need to enhance our information systems. We need high-throughput validated assays. And we need to really, I think, enhance our surveillance of these animals that have market access impact such that we're in a better position to basically both detect and respond. And one of the key covenants of all of the kind of stuff goes back to this PREM ID. And the U.S. pork industry has really embraced premise identification, okay, for lots of good reasons. But the thing about it is meaning that all these sites are signed up, right? Most every, like the pig producers are like at 98 or something. It's extremely high that people have them. But we don't necessarily use them, okay? And so one of the things for advancements in these kind of information technologies is to basically be able to connect the dots when needed is having premise IDs. And so one of the things that we've been working on with our peers at the diagnostic lab, our peer diagnostic labs, has been to say, how do we get premise IDs on VDL forms such that we're in a position to be able to have that as a system that's just routinely in place, going on in the background, so in the event that you need it, you can turn it on. Because one thing that's for certain in a crisis, you can't just turn on the switch. I mean, you have to have some sort of baseline thing running to have any chance of being able to respond when you really need it. And so we've established some user-friendly methods for people to order these things in mass for their system. Basically, just go on. We have a link, go online. They provide all the PREM IDs and the farm name, and this is for the vet, the vet's, the producer names, just because we're getting this request from the veterinarians. And so if they want to, say, print out these barcodes for their producers, and essentially then what they do is they just include those on their diagnostic lab submission forms. And then when they're in the lab, we just scan them in when they're entered, and it provides us a way to be able to, say, have that linkage such that we can have some infrastructure kind of running in the background. And the one thing, Core, I would say is that this PREM ID thing, so you'll probably hear more about that. You probably hear your vet maybe talk to you about that kind of thing, and how do we do that. But the reason why that there's really an effort to do that is it's kind of the foundation for preparedness and for these secure food supply programs. Okay? And the other thing is that's going on, one thing we're doing locally at the lab too is we're actually going through it. We're modifying not only our submission forms, but our LIMS, what we call our LIMS system, and to better capture premise level identifiers, as well as group, flow, lot, things like this. So there's just been a significant emphasis to say, because historically it was based on owners, but owners really don't have a lot to do with where the pigs are, right? And then pig people have other things they want to be able to track in their diagnostics, like not lot, flow, group, maybe service person, things like that. And so we've added a number of those sort of identifiers to be able to accomplish that.